A very good morning once again. Welcome to Rush Hour. My name is Lynn Komjisha. If you've just joined us, do go to our social media platforms. Be part of this conversation on Twitter at Urban TV Uganda. We are also on Twitter Spaces. We are on Facebook Live on Urban Television if you go to Facebook. But also look out for Lynn at LynnUG3 on Twitter and at Lynn Komjisha on Facebook. Now, you're in time for Big Issue. Today, being a Thursday, and we have been seeing news going around that the United Arab Emirates has issued new visa requirements, and people are a bit worried and a bit skeptical about it. They're wondering what all this is about. So it says it has revised its visa requirements, and some media say it has blacklisted Ugandans. I don't know if that's the right word to use, but that is what the media out there is reporting. The new rules governing the ways of how people work and live in the United Arab Emirates come into effect on October the 6th. So this is something that was approved by the cabinet in April, and this is one of the biggest shakeups to the country's immigration policy in years. Joining me to discuss that and so much more is none other than the ambassador, of course, to United Arab Emirates, but also to Dubai, particularly the Consul General of Dubai, and that is Ambassador Henry Mayega. Ambassador, sir, it's a pleasure having you here.
Thank you so much, and I think I'm also very happy for this opportunity.
Yeah, whenever you're around, we really race to get you.
That's right.
Fantastic. So let us start from really right there. Have our mannerisms become really bad? Are things that bad for us that we have been blacklisted?
I wouldn't say so, but of course, the first thing which I want to say is that we have very good bilateral relations between Uganda and the UAE, which UAE, many people understand it to be Dubai,
yes,
in Uganda, but the UAE is a very interesting country.
Yes.
Very friendly to Uganda. And the mission, the diplomatic mission, the diplomatic relations between Uganda and the UAE were established in 2008.
Okay.
And since then, these bilateral relations have been developing, growing, and they are very strong at the moment. And as you remember, President Yoweri Museveni visited in October last year during the start of the 2020 Expo, Dubai. And quite a number of agreements were signed. I don't want to go into that because that has been explained variously elsewhere. So the relations between Uganda, this is the point which I want to make, between Uganda and the UAE are very strong. And of course, what I've been seeing in the social media is not 100% accurate.
Okay.
In
this
as far
is why
as
we have you to make
know,
things clear.
Absolutely. So, which goes back to what you mentioned, that Ugandans have been blacklisted in the UAE.
Yeah.
That is not true as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's just normal procedure that from time to time a country revises its policies on immigration and so on and so forth. Even when I was still in China as deputy head of mission at the Uganda embassy, from time to time things would change for purposes of streamlining how immigration issues should be handled.
Yes.
And so I don't want to imagine that what the UAE has done is for purposes of really straining the relations between Uganda and the UAE. If anything, it is actually something that has been done to strengthen the already good bilateral relations, which are
developing. So what exactly
developing.
Has happened?
What has happened from what has happened is actually a requirement that whoever is looking for a job in the UAE from Uganda, which is normal procedure, because I mean I've been seeing these kinds of things happening. Like in China, to go back just a little bit for a second, the government of China would require from time to time that whoever goes to look for employment in China would get a certificate,
right,
usually from the Interpol.
Yes, certificate
of good conduct. And this is what the UAE has streamlined the immigration issue between Uganda and itself, by requiring that whoever goes for work, those who apply for work, should be required to have a certificate of good conduct, which is readily available for as long as you are not a criminal.
That's right.
From this country, you just walk into
but
Interpol and
new,
you present your
that's
paper.
That's been happening.
It's not new. Mm. It's just really a point of emphasis as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
And it has absolutely nothing to do with straining the relations between Uganda and the EU. It's just normal procedure and people have to get used to it.
Mm.
That a certificate of good conduct from your country, your
home country, becomes a requirement, because it's not only the UAE which does it.
Mm-hmm.
Even Uganda at one point in time definitely does it, that if somebody must come to work here and do all sorts of things, they are required to have a certificate of good conduct. And if you are really not a criminal, why should you be worried? Why should you be worried that they are requiring from you a certificate of good conduct? Because if you're not a criminal, then just proceed.
I like it
from the Interpol and then move on.
Ambassador, I like that you bring that up when you say why, if you're not a criminal, why are you worried? That reminds me of the 600 Ugandans that were deported. We'll come to that. But there's another requirement. The 5.3 million shillings, that is 5,000 dam.
That's not correct. It's not anywhere in the documents which I have seen.
Oh, really?
It's not correct that somebody is
required. You're supposed to have that on your account.
That's not a requirement, at least from the document which I have seen from the government of the UAE. I have not seen that kind of requirement. I think somebody just planted it into the social media.
Oh, really?
And probably it caught fire and everybody was jumping all over the place, believing that was correct.
One of our newspapers around in the country actually carried that story and included that. And they're saying that an insider in the Ugandan embassy in Abu Dhabi said that effective October 6th, no Ugandan will, or Nigerian, by the way, will be allowed into United Arab Emirates without a certificate of good conduct. And about 5,000 dam, which is about 5.3 million Uganda shillings, on their account.
Absolutely. But the requirement which I have seen from the government of the UAE, and as far as this immigration issue is concerned, is that Ugandans who are looking for employment in the UAE will be required to have a certificate of good conduct. And I have not seen the 5,000, which is mentioned. The 5,000 dirhams, by the way, which is being mentioned, is equivalent to 5 million Uganda shillings.
Yes.
That is not correct. That the UAE requires that people must have that money. No, that's not correct. But what has come out is very simple. Certificate of good conduct is going to be a requirement. It's not going to be a requirement. It's a requirement.
Mm-hmm.
It's an internationally respected procedure that if you must look for a job, you must not be a criminal.
Mm-hmm.
You must be somebody who has really a character that really suits the environment in the host country, and so that when you reach there, you don't become, you don't become somebody who tramples the law, and that's what the UAE government has done. That you must have that certificate of good conduct.
Why are these changes being made, and who are they targeting?
No, but as I said from the beginning of this conversation, that usually countries review their policies, their regulations, and their laws from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave an example that when I was still in China, if you spent probably something like a month when you're on your leave, and by the time you go back, a few things have changed.
Right.
There was a time, for instance, when fingerprints were not a requirement at the airport on arrival into China, into Beijing, and quite a couple of other cities, of course, of China. But then you go back and you find that it's a requirement that you must have those fingerprints. Of course, we as diplomats, we were not required in China to have our fingerprints taken by the government.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd just pass. But things keep changing. So probably in the wisdom of the government of the UAE, they have seen that it's extremely important that people should have a certificate of good conduct so that when they get into that country, they don't become a problem. And that is extremely important. For me, as far as I'm concerned, this is normal procedure. This is something that is procedural, and it has been done by quite a number of countries from time to time.
Agreed, Ambassador. But we have seen that in the last month, we saw over 600 Ugandans deported. They had overstayed their welcome, according to what we know, the reports that came from Dubai. And so when this comes on the heels of that, certainly we are bound to think that maybe we are ill-mannered. Maybe it's about time we checked our mannerisms.
Two things. The first one I want to say is that of course, there are over 100,000 Ugandans who live and work in the UAE.
Right.
And for me, that is a very comfortable, I mean, it's a huge number of our nationals that have gone to that place to find employment, get means of survival, and then to a very good degree, really remit colossal sums of money in the region of over $200 US million, mm-hmm. which is a plus to our economy.
That's true.
And so that one is a very interesting thing, that you have over 100,000 Ugandans who live and work in the UAE. And out of those, if we are only talking about 600 who have actually got estranged by the system in that country, for me, that is not a representation of the entire body of Ugandans that live in the UAE mm. and work there, mm. because these are really making additions to our economy. 600, yes, because in a majority of cases, these people overstayed their visa, mm-hmm. Visas to the UAE. And once that happens, definitely you find yourself clashing with the law in the country. And this is not something that only applies to the UAE. Even in Uganda here, I've seen the police, for instance, look going for people who have overstayed their visas.
True.
And it's really a normal procedure as far as I'm concerned, that a country from time to time will have to look for those who have overstayed their visas, irrespective of whether it is UAE or Uganda or China or even in Europe itself. So every Ugandan, I think, is advised that when you are traveling to any country, not only the UAE, mm. you must make sure that your visa is valid so that you don't enter into problems. And that's how a majority of those 600 that you're talking about actually ended up in problems. The other one which probably I want to speak about is the fact that Uganda needs to improve their work ethics.
Mm-hmm.
In that, I think, field, I think we're not doing very well.
Mm.
We're not doing very well because why, for instance, do you have to abscond from a job? And you don't probably want to.
But there are cases, there are reports of being of mistreatment, there are reports of not paying.
Yeah, but
being
you
paid.
See, because for me, I don't want to trust most of the things which actually appear in social media. Because social media normally, usually, is going to build a mountain out of a mound.
But what comes, what and reports come to your desk?
Of course, there are quite a number of places. I mean, because in whatever country you go to, you are definitely not going to find everybody really behaving angelic, like an angel.
Right.
So there are probably those isolated cases. But by and large, in my view, a majority of Ugandans who live in the UAE are doing a very good job. They are in their places of work. They are earning an income, which income helps them to survive. And at the same time, part of it is sent here. And it's an addition to the cost. So if there are a few who have found themselves in trouble, you know, as far as their visa requirements are concerned, mm-hmm. then that's something that we need to look at. But I've also mentioned the issue of work ethics,
yes.
where we need to improve as Ugandans, so that when you get an employment, make sure that you work diligently so that the employer also feels happy, because there are quite a number of problems. I mean, when most of these people actually go to the UAE to find employment,
mm.
and it's a new environment. Mm. Somebody has not been out of the country, and it's for the first time that this person actually is living outside his country or her country.
Yes.
And there is that cultural shock, normally, which you get.
But when you say cultural shock, our labor people that are taken for work usually undergo training.
I hear about that training, but as to whether it is thorough or not, that's a totally different story. But the fact of the matter is that many people, once they are in those places, they get that cultural shock. They are staying away for the very first time from their families, and they are going to feel a little bit estranged
mm-hmm.
From their country and so on and so forth, because the cultures are new, the country is new, the environment is new.
So if you're estranged, must you misbehave?
Really? You shouldn't misbehave, and precisely that's where probably why I was mentioning that it's extremely important for us to improve our work ethics. And I've seen it even in Uganda here, because when you, for instance, you look at many of these hotels that we have,
mm-hmm.
quite a number of substantial numbers of employees in those hotels are actually foreigners.
Yes.
I've seen so many Kenyans here.
True.
Why? The reason is simple, that probably our work ethics are still lacking in terms of strength and so on and so forth. And therefore, we need to improve in that area.
Ugandans are badly mannered.
But we can improve. There is room for improvement.
Absolutely.
And we need, how we do it, I don't know. We must scratch our heads. And then we'll find solutions to this problem. So somebody gets out of this country, he goes to work in the UAE or any other country.
Mm-hmm.
And for the very first time, this person finds himself or herself out of an environment in which he has lived or she has lived for so many years, and becomes a totally new environment, and coping with that environment becomes a problem.
Employers take advantage of all that.
Of course, all of us employ people.
Yes.
And I will try as much as possible to get so much out of these people who we are employing, but I don't think that a majority of them, a majority of those employers, are actually mistreating our nationals. Because given the fact that we have 100,000 Ugandans who live and work in the UAE, and you find only about 600 to 1,000 people who have found themselves in problems, that, in my view, cannot be representative of the entire number of body of Ugandans who live and work in the UAE.
Mm-hmm.
It is simply something that is usually, it usually happens, not only in the UAE, but probably even elsewhere, that you find yourself that, you find yourself estranged a little bit because you're in a new country and so on and so forth. The fact of the matter is, most Ugandans who live in the UAE are happily living and work, happily living and working in that country.
Why don't we get these stories, Ambassador? For example, how about, what have you done within your jurisdiction as Ambassador to perhaps quell the negativity?
The negativity usually is spewed in the social media. They have absolutely no control over the social media.
That's true, but the best I can do something about it.
Absolutely. The best I can do is very simple, of course, is writing in the newspapers, giving advisories, and also offering consular support to those who are staying in the UAE. We check on them where it's possible, and given the resources that we have, because we can't move from one place to another all the time. We offer consular support to those who are actually estranged, and we advise them on what to do. There are quite a couple of things which have also been happening, because I can mention to you quite a number of, for instance, members of parliament who have actually traveled to the UAE, specifically to Dubai, and they found themselves in problems. The reason being that once you have a red passport, an unofficial passport, and this is something for the benefit of Ugandans that I should mention in this talk show, that once you have either a red passport or unofficial passport, don't go to a vendor to get a visa to the UAE. You're supposed to go to the embassy of the UAE to get a visa.
They don't know that?
They don't know, because we have got quite a number of them, members of parliament and quite a number of other government officials who have actually got their visas from the vendors. And those visas are going to be rejected the moment you have a red passport or an official passport. It's only the ordinary passport pass holder who goes to a vendor to get a visa. This one must be very clear, because we have had quite a number of cases. I don't want to name names, including last week, where a member of parliament was actually in Dubai and was stuck there. They couldn't allow him to exit, but it was because he had got his visa, despite the fact that he carries an official passport as an MP. He was given a visa from a vendor, and he found himself in problems. So Ugandans must understand that once you have a red passport and an official passport, the place to go once you want a visa is the UAE embassy on Kitante Road. Let me be specific.
Oh, Kitante Road. Kitante Road in
yes,
Dubai?
The Kitante Road. Once you are applying for a visa here in Uganda, yes, in Kampala. Kitante Road, that's where you're supposed to get your visa.
Right. Not now, from Ambassador, the vendor. Let's talk about our local companies here that of course take Ugandans to the United Arab Emirates. With these new requirements, are they going to affect their operations in any way? And or are they going to improve those operations?
There are two things which I want to mention here. Is that the government has put in place a policy, and there is also a committee of parliament which is putting together a bill so that it can be passed on the floor of parliament, and of course eventually the president is going to sign it, to streamline labor exportation worldwide, not only to the UAE. That's extremely important for people to understand, that there is something that is in the offing, and it's being mooted by a group of MPs as a private member's bill, and it will come to parliament. They were recently to the UAE and quite a number of other countries trying to gather views and so on and so forth, in order to make sure that there is a law that governs or guides labor exportation from Uganda. That will be extremely important.
Here.
And we have quite a number of them, absolutely. So many companies are here. But the second one, which I want to mention in relation to your question, is the fact that the UAE and Uganda have signed a memorandum of understanding.
Yes.
It is at the level of implementation. The two technical teams, one from the UAE and one from Uganda, are supposed to put their heads together. And that technical team, I think, was selected by the Minister of Gender and Labour. And it is supposed to work with another team in the UAE to implement that MOU. And once those two things are done, I'm cocksure that it would be possible that the firms that export labor from here to the world would definitely have to work within the confines of the law so that there are no these problems. Because the MOU, for instance, I want to make to mention it for the benefit of our listeners,
right,
that MOU talks about, for instance, specifically that when before somebody actually boards a plane to go to the UAE, you must be certain that there is a job. Two, you must know about how much you're going to pay. Three, there are medical insurance issues, mm-hmm, and quite a couple of other things which are extremely important as far as somebody who is looking for a job in the UAE. So the MOU talks about all those things.
Okay.
I've abridged them.
Yes.
Otherwise, there are quite a number of things that are spelled out in that MOU. Now, plus this law, I think will then streamline labor exportation. All the firms that are involved in labor exportation from here will definitely have to be guided by those two documents. And in my view, I think many of the problems that Ugandans have been finding in as far as going to UAE are concerned will be resolved.
It's very interesting. We have already a lot of paperwork, if I could use that, in regard to labor externalization in Uganda. What is being done on the other side where this labor is exported to? Because if the problem is cleared or sorted from here in Uganda, then definitely the other side also needs to work on. So what else is happening on the other side?
Of course, what's happening on the other side is a very interesting one, because in my view, a number of people, again, from Uganda are working comfortably in that country. Now, there are countries that have sent huge numbers, probably by 1,000 times the number of Uganda, like Pakistanis and Indians and Filipinos.
Mm-hmm.
Huge numbers of them working in the UAE. I want to point it out that the population of citizens of the UAE is about 2 million people.
Mm-hmm.
But the foreigners who are working in that country are actually 80 million.
Wow.
So out of the 80 million, again, it goes back to the argument that I've been making. Out of the 80 million, how many of those 8 million are actually estranged or have found themselves against, Trump being, against the law in the UAE, so to speak? You'll find that a majority actually are comfortably living in the UAE, So, to go back to your question, What's happening on the other side is that like a majority
laws
of the foreigners who live and work in the UAE, including myself, are actually very comfortable. Because the moment you observe all the laws, let Ugandans understand that there is no country in this world where you're going to live and work, and then you break the laws or policies or regulations, and you think that people are going to massage you. Nobody's going to massage you for as long as you break the laws of that country.
So, in short, we are not really abiding by the regulations, if that is what you're trying to say.
Absolutely. I mean, when you reach a point of deportation, I've seen deportations, for instance, from here.
Yes,
you remember
Chaka Chaka
came here to sing shortly before the elections.
And
she thought that she would behave like a Ugandan, getting involved in our laws. She was deported. So it's not only the UAE that deports people who actually cross the red lines of the law. Even Uganda does it. For as long as you're going to cross the red lines of the law, definitely
you're
a candidate for deportation.
Ugandans claim that the other foreigners that you've already talked about, the Filipinos, the Pakistanis, are being treated better than Ugandans. And so it seems like it is only Ugandans who are, ill-mannered or unlucky.
Absolutely. A very important question. Because what has happened, for instance, between the Philippines and the UAE is that they already have an existing MOU.
Mm.
Yeah.
So
we are just developing ours.
On?
Because the Philippines established an embassy in the UAE a long time ago. Ours only came the other day, 2008. And so we are just going through the processes of ensuring that labor exportation and quite a couple of other things are actually streamlined.
Mm-hmm.
So the Philippines has been having an embassy there. Pakistan has been having an embassy there for very long, longer than ourselves. Even India as well has been having an embassy there for a very, very long time. And so you're not going to put in place these collaborative arrangements between the two countries in just 1 week. It takes a little bit of time. So we are just developing an MOU. Now, of course, you are saying that those are favored. I don't think they are favored real as such. Because in a majority of cases, the pay is the same.
Mm.
And as I was saying, that the UAE has got a minimum wage.
Yes, you're mentioning
that. So the moment you have the basic qualifications, the moment you have that employment, there are so many Ugandans, as I mentioned it to you before we came here for this conversation, who are working in airports, the airport of Dubai, for instance. There are so many Ugandans who are really having good employment. They're working in hotels, they're working in malls, they're working in supermarkets, and they're comfortably working there. Of course, they are away from home, and being away from home, definitely that estranges a little bit.
Ambassador, when you say good, doing well, they have good work, they're going, when you keep saying good, and you're not mentioning the housemaids, the house helps, the ones that usually, the biggest number that comes from Uganda.
I must tell Ugandans that actually most of our problems, most Ugandans who get into problems are the ones who work as maids.
Yes.
Those ones definitely, I mean, once you work in a domestic home, even supervision becomes a problem. And that's why the MOU that has been signed between Uganda and the UAE comes in handy to solve many of those problems, because it will spell out the terms of employment, so to speak. I mean, I talked about, for instance, contractual obligations.
Yes.
I mean, you can talk about how much is going to be paid, medical insurance, how the length of the contract. I'm expected, for instance, to work for 3 years or 2 years. Those are spelled out, are going to be spelled out once the MOU, which was signed between Uganda and the UAE, is actualized, implemented, and for the benefit of everybody, I mean, then many of these problems, in my view, are going to be resolved, and it will be less of them.
Now, let's talk about the issue of remittances. There was talk as the story broke of the new requirements for the visa for United Arab Emirates. People were saying that UAE is one of the biggest, you know, it remits a lot of money into the country, and they were feeling that this is going to be affected. The remittances.
I don't think so, because,
but
as I said,
the biggest number do not have the requirements that are going to there.
Already we are having that body of 100,000 who are actually living and working in the UAE.
Already minus the 1,000 you mentioned.
But minus 1,000, which in my view is very paltry. That is a small number.
Okay.
And this labor exploitation is continuing. It's continuing. And I just want to say, probably as an addition, that not all the firms that are involved in labor exploitation are actually doing a bad job. That's why a small number of them really got into trouble with the government policy here. But a majority of them are doing a good job, and that's why a majority of Ugandans who have been exported into the UAE are actually comfortable working in their places of work. For me, that is a plus already. And all we need to do is to emphasize the other two documents. If the law can come through Parliament very quickly and the MOU is actualized, implemented, I think many of our problems, in as far as labor exploitation is concerned,
will
be resolved. Of course, you're talking about remittances, which is a very, very important subject, because given the fact that we have just gone through the pandemic and then these Ukraine issues, which, of course, the Russians have said they are denazifying that country, in my view, and rightly so, because, I mean, you cannot expect somebody causing trouble near your border and you think somebody is going just to clap their hands and so on and so forth. But, of course, that is an argument for another day.
Yeah.
But remittances are extremely important, because the diaspora in the UAE remits to Uganda over $200 million per year. And for me, that's a very big plus. And it is because these people have got an employment there. Because they have those jobs there, they earn an income, and part of it, of course, is for survival. And they have done quite substantial amounts of projects, number of projects in the country, back home, in their home country, in Uganda, building, buying land. You hear all sorts of stories. When you meet these Ugandans in the UAE, they tell you about their projects, buying land, building a house, looking after their parents, and sending money for, you know, to save, saving money. The culture of saving money is extremely important, in as far as we are concerned. Because when I was in China, their culture was that somebody actually saves beyond 50% of what they earn. Now, how an average Ugandan in this country of mine, how much do they save? Because you save, then invest. But what are the savings? The last time I checked, I think we're doing in the region of something like 15 to 20% of what we earn.
We're not doing well in terms of savings.
Absolutely. But the Chinese were doing it up to 50% of what they earn. You save it and then invest. You know, so if the people, if Ugandans who are in the UAE and in the rest of the countries in the diaspora, Ugandans who are living in the diaspora are actually saving this money for purposes of putting up projects and sending monies to their accounts, mm-hmm. we are having an arrangement which is in the offing with the Housing Finance Bank, so that it does a collaboration with the Association of Ugandans who live in the UAE, so that when they actually save those monies, they can be channeled through through Housing Finance Bank, mm. and then
to also avoid a lot of bad manners.
Absolutely, but also Housing Finance Bank mm. has a component within their policy
right.
that once you bank with them, mm. they will advise you on which are the most profitable projects.
Exactly.
So we are working on that, and we believe that. Before the end of this year, some kind of an arrangement is worked out. Mm-hmm. And of course, we are having business forums in the UAE, three of them. The first one will be on the 10th of October. It will be in Abu Dhabi, and it will be coordinated by the Embassy of Uganda in Abu Dhabi. The second one will be in Dubai on the 11th of October, and it will be coordinated by the Consulate of Uganda in Dubai. The last one, the last business forum is going to be in Sharjah, which is another emirate. As
yes,
I said
yes.
before, mm-hmm. UAE has got seven emirates,
yes.
and each one of them is a kind of a federal arrangement. And so these are really best opportunities. And to these business forums, we have invited quite a number of people, members of parliament, Housing Finance is going to be there. And of course, that is something that is going to give an opportunity to the to the diaspora in the UAE to make sure that they can work out things with the but besides those business forums mm-hmm. there is also a convention of the diaspora in the UAE which is going to take place between the 29th of October to the 30th of October, and this is going to give an opportunity, and of course Housing Finance is going to be part of that. They have already agreed to come and attend.
Okay.
And they will advise the diaspora accordingly.
Now, Ambassador, back to the issue of mannerisms, and how do we deal with it? Because it looks like our people got to United Arab Emirates and literally, like you said, cultural shock. But then again, they lack basic training. They lack basic training to work in there. Now, the Minister for Gender was saying that there's still a number of challenges, including the lack of an efficient monitoring system for migrant workers in those destination countries.
Absolutely, and that's why I think the law, which is in the offing through Parliament, is going to answer those questions. Because before you export somebody to go and work in a foreign country, they have to be trained so that you prepare their psychology for the new environment into which they are going. And once that is spelled out in the law, it will, of course, the law is going to spell out what the responsibilities are for the labor exportation companies or firms. And then those things as a requirement for labor exportation will be emphasized to the latter. In my view, therefore, the issue of ethics, the issue of good work ethics, in as far as those who get exported into foreign countries, will definitely have parameters within which to behave and make sure that their stay mm-hmm. in those countries is as comfortable as possible, because it will be possible for the farms on the ground here, because they are still problematic, as you and I must have agreed.
Yes.
I must agree, in as far as that industry is concerned, that these labor exportation farms definitely have to be guided, because we don't have a law
sure.
that guides them on how to do these things. And once there is that gap, somebody is just groping in the dark. They don't know exactly how this thing is going to be conducted. How, you know, I was listening to stories of people being removed from their villages, and then
they're
being crammed in which borders actually on human trafficking. So
yes.
before we speak about what's happening even outside, I think we must speak about the things that obtain, that the thing, we must speak about the things that really happen here before labor is exported. That do we really have the requisite processes on the ground that ensure that when somebody gets out of this country, they have legally been, recruited, and are we sure that the job is there, and so on and so forth. But of course, there are also many Ugandans, by the way. It's not only companies that do these things. There are many Ugandans who go to the UAE
and
as tourists. And once they're in the UAE, then they want to change their status. They say, but after all, I can find a job here. And those are also quite a number of them.
What is going to happen to this one?
What's going to happen to those ones is that, of course, they're not going to find those jobs very easily.
Okay.
And they are going to overstay their visas. And the system in that place is going to find you out. And the next thing that is going to happen is actually for you to be deported. There are quite a number of those cases. And even when I was in China, we used to have those stories. There is a girl, for instance, who was, I think, encouraged by friends, and these were real people, I think, who were trafficking human beings from here. There was a girl who had a kiosk in Mbarara. We handled this case when I was in Beijing. And she had a kiosk, then she sold the kiosk to somebody because she was promised there was a job in China. And this girl got all the money to buy a ticket for herself. I don't know whether some people added money to her. And she flew to China only to find that there was no job. And those who encouraged her to go there eventually told her that, look, what you do, in the meantime, you can do prostitution. Mm-hmm. Because the job that had been promised is not available at the moment. But we'll get your job. So they take away the passport from this girl, and she came running to the embassy. And these are some of the problems that we go through.
Mm.
So Nkunjinja and others who have been making noise here in social media should be aware of these things, that in the majority of cases, these people are actually sometimes find themselves in problems because they themselves have actually made wrong choices. So before Nkunjinja speaks about these things and he goes to the social media blasting everybody and so on and so forth, we have to understand where we are coming from, where we are, and where we need to go
as far as labor exploitation is concerned. Nkunjinja, there have been reports also that the embassies are not doing enough to help these people.
Of course, when you talk about 600 people, actually, they almost went to the number of 1,000. The embassy can only offer you consular support to give you advice on how to resolve the problems. For instance, when you get estranged from your employer, especially as far as maids are concerned, what do we do for you? Definitely, we don't have money for the ticket for you.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have money to buy you an air ticket. We don't have really enough money to accommodate everybody who gets estranged. So what we did, the government of Uganda has been gracious because it has provided money to have some kind of a home for these people. We have one in Abu Dhabi, where at any one point in time we can only accommodate 8 people who are estranged or stranded.
Oh.
8 people. And we have given the priority.
What happened?
And we have given the priority to girls.
If there are more, what happened?
That is our capacity. That's the capacity we have as an embassy. So before Nkunjinja makes noise here, he should understand these things. And for him to have come here to tell lies that he visited the consulate in Dubai 3 times is a lie. He came there once and he assumed, because he didn't even make an appointment. He simply said, I want to come there when unannounced, you know? And so he just came to the consulate. It was, I think, something like in the afternoon. And at that time, I think I'd gone with Ambassador Zake.
Mm-hmm.
We had an engagement with investors who bring money here, not like Nkunjinja, who takes away money from the economy. Yeah?
Maybe
so extremely important for people to understand that, look,
maybe the
we
role
have these
of
numbers.
Of embassies and consulates.
Yeah.
Mm.
The role of the company, of course, that's what we do. We can only offer you consular support, advise you on how to resolve, should you have problems with, for instance, your employer, how should you resolve, and how should these things legally be done.
Right.
That we can do. But of course, we cannot say that we have 100% capacity to be in the entire UAE, yeah, because as I've told you, we have 7 emirates. And we can only be in one place at one time and resolve probably one case. Absolutely. Like one time, for instance, when there is a city called Al Ain in Abu Dhabi. There was a group of Ugandans, girls actually to be specific, who were smuggled from here and taken into a building and they were doing prostitution. And I'm not going to name names. And they were doing prostitution. So the mission, the diplomatic mission in Abu Dhabi, had to send a team there to resolve that together with the authorities of the UAE. And these girls were actually extricated from that problem. They were removed from that problem. And then eventually, I think the tickets were found for them to get out of the UAE and come back home. And that's what we can do. And we can only do it at one time, not all the time, because the capacity is not available.
Well, you've got to show that you're working, you're
Absolutely.
Doing some work.
Absolutely.
But ambassadors, we wind up. There were reactions towards this story. that the new requirements and how they affect Ugandans. So somebody on social media was saying that Uganda Ministry of Foreign Affairs needs to intervene with diplomatic relations to support Ugandan workers in United Arab Emirates. If you could take note of that. Another one said, at least we'll have fewer cases of human trafficking, organ harvesting, and dead youth returning from abusive employers. Then the last one was saying, Ugandans are not blacklisted. United Arab Emirates changed its visa regulations. Ugandans on visit visas and tourists are required to have at least 5 million on their accounts. Those with employment visas are not affected by this regulation.
The 5,000, as I said at the beginning of this conversation, is not correct.
Okay.
Or
so we are not blacklisted as a country.
There is no black. This is something that every country does.
Okay.
Certificate of good conduct. Mm-hmm. If you are not a criminal, why would you be fearful of presenting
right.
a certificate of good conduct? If you're a good citizen, like many are. The 100,000 Ugandans who are in the UAE, mm-hmm. they're just comfortable. But if you must go against the laws of another country,
right.
your host country, then you're going to run into problems. You're going to run into problems.
So the other two, someone was saying that we need to engage the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to intervene in diplomatic relations
There are no problems with the diplomatic relations between the UAE and Uganda. They are superb. We have very good diplomatic relations between the UAE. And there is no need for even the Minister of Foreign Affairs to intervene and do what? We are strengthening those relations. As I've said, the President visited last year, and he met with the leadership of the UAE. Many agreements were signed. In fact, we're in the business of implementing all of those. One of the firms in the UAE called Elite Agro is going to put up 7 tea factories in this country. And Lulu Group of Supermarkets has stepped up the 2 million bar at which we're exporting agricultural produce into the UAE to 10
wonderful,
million
wonderful.
And quite a number of other things.
And
so this is the business that happens between two countries that actually have good
working
bilateral relations.
Right. The last one, at least we will have fewer cases of human trafficking, organ harvesting, and dead youth returning from abuse.
I have not heard about harvesting of human organs in the UAE.
But we have had these cases coming.
In the UAE, I'm not talking about any other country. I'm talking about the UAE.
Okay.
Our relations are good. We have not had cases of, let me be categorical.
Mm.
There are no cases of organ
harvesting
in the UAE targeting Ugandans. I've not heard about that one. Unless it happened last night.
Mm-mm.
It is not there. Absolutely not.
Okay,
that one I'm
so
very sure of.
In your conclusive remarks, Ambassador.
All I want to say is that many of these firms, of course, are doing a good job by exporting labor because, I mean, like the Filipinos, the economy is partly strong as a result of the remittances.
Mm-hmm.
So let the firms be regulated so that they can export labor in a streamlined way.
Okay.
Let also Ugandans have good work ethics, because if they will not, they will definitely find themselves in a lot of problems. And when you get there, just understand the laws of that country. Because in the UAE, for instance, when you litter, there is a fine for you.
Mm.
When you commit a traffic offense, a fine is waiting for you. Nobody's going to look for you until you're at the point of exit at the airport. Is when they get your Emirates ID and then plug it into the system, and then they find all these things. So be sure that definitely when you cross the red lines of law, you're going to have problems. Keep the laws in the UAE, have good work ethics, let the firms here be regulated, and we should speed up the process of ensuring that we implement the MOU between Uganda and the UAE.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Ambassador, for making time to join us this morning on the big issue today when we've been trying to look at the new requirements for the visa for United Arab Emirates. And he has put everything in context. We have not been blacklisted as a country, and these requirements are really not as scary as they sound. First of all, he has said the 5 million is nowhere. He has not seen that anywhere as a requirement. So we'll definitely get more details, and if anything comes up, he is here. He'll definitely be able to clarify more. So we're going to take a break. When we return, we are looking at the joy in Sanyu. Meet the best of Bukedde's Sanyu. You take a look at that, a very interesting page that my co-host Mubarak Mugabo enjoys a lot with Miles in just a bit. So do stick around. Don't go anywhere.